Good morning, Bayside. How are you? If you're in the lobby, why don't you come in and join us? We're going to worship together. Would you stand with us this morning? Hold on. I think we're going to start over again. 2 seconds. Sorry, this doesn't normally happen to me. If I can't hear myself, then you can't hear me. That's better. Let's try this again. Good morning, Bayside. How are you? Would you stand with us this morning? We're going to worship together. I was buried. I was standing beneath my shame. Who can carry that kind away? It was my tomb till I met you. I was freeing, but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You call my name. Now your mercy,
now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old man knew Jesus when I met you. You come.
Shout his praise this morning. Amen to him.
Good morning, Bayside. Go ahead and tell someone around you good morning. All right. Good morning. My name is Bethany, and I am the kids director here, and I just want to welcome you all this morning. We have a lot of stuff going on, so I'm going to try to do the quick version, but please look in your bulletin for all the details to everything. But first of all, tonight is something that I rather enjoy personally, bingo night. Do you guys like bingo? So bingo tonight is at 5 o'clock right here. Come have fun with us. This is a good way for you to get to know people in our church in a whole different light. Let me tell you, we have like a lot of competitive people in our church and it's really fun. So bingo night tonight, you don't want to miss it. Group link, Thursday, 6:30. If you hate cooking as much as I do, come to group link. Eat, get a little Jesus, some friends. It's a fun time. Come, group link. Judges, it's going to be awesome. Baby bottle fundraiser. We are raising money for the Pregnancy Resource Center. There are baby bottles in the back. Go ahead and grab one, fill it up with your change, and bring it back. Every cent makes a difference. So let's bless some mamas and their babies through that. Valentine's dinner for the rockers is coming up. So if you are a rocker, which is... I don't know what I want to be. Retired age, Rocker's Valentine party is for you. And last but not least, save your stuff. We are going to have an all-church yard sale out front supporting our kids that are going to camp. So if you have stuff that is sellable, then please save it, and we're going to be collecting it and raising money for our kids to go to camp. On that note, if you have a kid that's going in from fourth grade all the way through senior in high school and they are interested in camp, go online to Frontier Ranch and sign them up today, because we have some spots reserved, but they are going to be open to the wait list starting next week. So if you want your kids to go to camp this summer, go online and get them signed up right now. If you have any questions about camp, please come see me. I'd love to talk to you all about camp. But on that note, I'm going to pray for our offering. Dear Lord Jesus, I just thank you so much for today. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to come to your house, to leave everything outside those doors and come and worship and learn about you today, Lord. I just pray that you will bless our message today, that you will bless the teachers serving our kids today. And Lord, I just pray that you will be honored and glorified through our giving. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. And all the overwhelming, ever-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah. Oh. There's no shadow. There's no shadow you won't light up. Mountain you won't climb up. Coming after me. That's right, church. Let's sing.
There's no wall you won't kick down. Lie you won't tear down. Coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up. Mountain you won't climb up. Coming after me.
That's right.
No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
There's no shadow,
there's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
No,
there's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Your name cannot be overcome.
morning, church. Curtis is taller than I thought. So as a lot of you guys know, today is the first Sunday of the month. And on the first Sunday of the month, we do communion. And you can do it whenever, but it's just a good reminder that God did something amazing for us. He sent his son to be broken, to die on a cross. And no matter what we're going through right now, we have a God who can take that from us. We have a God who has given us the ultimate sacrifice. And I'm just going to read out of if you want to start getting your wafer ready. It's a little plastic on top. It's quite hard sometimes. I'm going to read 1 Corinthians 11, 23-26. It says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he gave thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's partake of the body. Father God, we just thank you, Lord, for your broken body, Father God, that you sent your son to pay for something that he had no business paying for, Father God. And we just thank you for that, Jesus. In the same way, he also took... I'll try to open this with one hand. He also took the cup... After supper, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Particular cup. Father God, we thank you for the blood that you shed. For the cross you bore for us, Father God. For your broken body, Lord. And we thank you that we're able to do this with you, Father God, to remember what you did for us so long ago, Father God. And we just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Spirit of the
oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. I am yours, you are mine, you are my God, I love you, Lord,
and I lift my voice to
we declare, I
love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice my King in what you.
We lift it all to you, God, today. I hope that it is a sweet sound in your ear, God. No matter what key you hear it in today, it all comes from love today, God. So we lift your name on high. Your praise, God, that's what we are after. Heavenly Father, I pray these words today that we hear, your words, that they stay with us, because they need to, God. That we hear them, but that we get to know them, just like we try to get to know you better and better every day. Heavenly Father, we say all this in your precious name. The name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen.
All right, good morning. Kids, you may be dismissed to run to your class. We've also got a couple young ladies coming around with the bag if you want to get rid of the communion cup. I think we're getting close to being over the communion cups. Can I get an amen for those? I know you love the wafer. I know you love that wafer, and it's so easy to get out. But I think our days of those portable communion cups are almost over. So that's good news. But good morning. My name is Jason. If you don't know me, I'm one of the pastors here at Bayside Church in Galt. We are just excited that you're joining us online and in person this morning. And we've got an exciting day and message for you today just to work through as we continue in our series from Nehemiah. So who's excited for the Super Bowl? Raise your hand if you're excited for the Super Bowl. Four of you. Awesome. Awesome. There may be a few more than that. So if we're talking Super Bowl, is the Bengals going to win? Tell me. Come on. Bengals? Underdog story, right? How about the Rams? Wow, okay, 49er fans, I see where we're at. I see where we're at, 49er fans. We're still harboring a little bit of bitterness, yes, from that game. Speaking of sports, how many of you guys are watching the Winter Olympics? How many of you guys are starting to watch the Winter Olympics? Tell me, what are some of your events that you like most of Winter Olympics? Just shout them out. Figure skating. The what is it? The skiers fall. And when you fall at those speeds, it's not good. It's not good. What else? Skiing, figure skating? What? Curling. Because it's super odd, right? That they just do this on the ice and make the thing go. What's that? Yeah. Crazy. Thank you. But athletes from all over the world that are high profile athletes are competing to win a prize. They're competing for fame. They're competing for fortune, some of them, maybe deals that they get afterwards. And they're competing to get recognized, to get noticed. They're competing to win a medal. And preferably a gold medal is something they would be shooting for. I mean, who wouldn't want to be in the Olympics? Who wouldn't want to have all that attention and maybe at your highest level of the game that you're playing? I'm pretty sure that maybe most of us in this room probably will not be in the Olympics, if we're being honest. We might not make that. Maybe a slim chance. Am I wrong? Okay, maybe some of you are. But there's a story of a guy named Stefan Sigmund from Romania who was trying for many years to be recognized, to get his name in the Guinness World Book of Records. Has anyone tried to break a Guinness World Book of Record here in the room? Okay, you have. That's awesome. What was it for, if you could say? The longest softball game. The longest softball game. Awesome. But those are fun books. My son loves to look at the Guinness World Book of Records just to see what people were doing. But this guy named Stefan was trying to get recognized. He was trying to get noticed. And so he had a recent attempt was using this contraption that looked like a filter for a car, and he managed to smoke 800 cigarettes at one time. So that's a feat. It's different than a softball game. Just to come to find out that Guinness World Book of Records doesn't accept those type of challenges anymore. So after all the 800 cigarettes smoking, he didn't even get his name in the book. He went on to try. He ate 29 hard-boiled eggs in 4 minutes to break the record. Unfortunately, at that time, Guinness stopped taking the gluttony things out of the record book. And then he tried one more time. He jumped into a lake from a 135-foot cliff, only to find out the record for diving from a fixed point had already been set at 176 feet. That guy just kept trying, right? He just kept trying to get noticed. He wanted to be noticed for something. He wanted to be recognized for something. And we all have that in ourselves. We all love to be, you know, whether it's you work hard at your work or you do something for your family or for someone else, it's nice to be recognized sometimes. Just it makes you feel good. Would you agree with that? And so we're kind of always kind of seeking that in some sort of a way. And Olympians are doing that. Sports athletes are doing that. They're trying to be recognized for the work that they're putting in and the game that they're playing. I remember, I don't know how many of you were Cub Scout parents. Any Cub Scout parents in the room? None of you. Okay, a couple of you. Thank you. So the Cub Scouts, I remember when Josh did Cub Scouts and Boy Scouts and the Pinewood Derby race. And I think sometimes the parents, like the dads, had a harder time with the racing that helped the kid build the thing. But Josh would, every year we did the same one. It was a cheese wedge because they seemed to do well. And I don't think we had the skill set to do something different. But we would do the cheese wedge. And I remember him racing this down the track and all the kids so excited. And one year he actually did really well in it. And he won his little class. And to see the face that he made and the excitement and the joy that something he had been a part of succeeded and he was noticed for that achievement is something that I won't forget. And the passage that we're going to be studying today is a list of people who achieved some pretty major accomplishments. We're continuing, like I said, in our study of the book of Nehemiah. And Nehemiah might not be like the book, your go-to book that you're always reading, and probably especially chapter 3. And we're going to read chapter 3, and it might not be one that you just, it's your go-to passages. But we can see how God can use all of us when our hearts are open. And I don't know if you've experienced that in your life, is that when you're open to something, when you're open to maybe change in your life, God has so much more success when you're out of the way, right? When you have your heart open to whatever God's plan is, God can use you in so many more ways than if your heart is closed to where he may be leading. Nehemiah sure takes me back, I know, to my Simpson College Bible days. And I took an Old Testament class, and I'll tell you, I was on the struggle bus in that class. Old Testament is very, very difficult, especially when you're like 20 years old taking it. I struggle with school, period. But I remember that class and just trying to learn and trying to gain so much wisdom from these amazing professors, only that I struggled so much. But what's amazing is once we get past some of those difficult words to pronounce, some of the names which you're going to see this morning we're going to list that I'm going to butcher, But once you get past some of those things, God did some amazing things in the passages from the Old Testament. And we're going to unpack that a little bit today. And so let me just pray real quick as we get going into our message. Father God, we just thank you for today. God, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your forgiveness. God, we thank you for your love. And we're here today, God, as your imperfect, so imperfect children. God, just seeking you, asking you to touch our lives. God, maybe those places in our heart that has been calloused or have been hurt or broken, God, we just pray that you would help mend that. God, you would help us and provide us encouragement. And those that are going through some tough times today, God, may this be a place where they can see some love, some encouragement, and some blessings from you, from your word today. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. So a little bit of history. As we've kind of been unpacking the book of Nehemiah, chapter 1 and chapter 2, we see that in 1586 BC, Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonian army captured the Jews. Jerusalem was destroyed, and the walls were knocked down. The temple was burned in Jerusalem. The people were deported, and they were forced into slavery, and Jerusalem was left in ruins. And so what was once this huge place and such a place of trade and commodity and worship was instantly knocked down when it was taken over and burned. God did not forsake his people. He moved King Cyrus to make a decree to let some of the Jews return. And in three stages, over 150 years, they were allowed to migrate back to Jerusalem, only to discover that the city was demolished and it was desolate. Through Nehemiah's prayer in chapter 1, we learned that he was concerned about the problem of Jerusalem's desolation. And so God had something more for Jerusalem. God wanted to see Jerusalem fulfilled and restored once again. People were confident in God's promises. They were confident enough to be involved and to get involved in the rebuilding. Nehemiah replenished the resources, assessed the need. He recruited workers. He inspired confidence, and he handled the opposition, which came the entire time that he was rebuilding those walls. He was faced with opposition, one thing after another. Nehemiah charged forward to accomplish the impossible. I want to read chapter 3. So settle in your seats for a second, because it's a lot of verses. This is where I wish I would have asked someone to read this that's really, really good at reading. But I want to read, it's the Word of God. I want to read it this morning. I want to read the whole chapter. What this is talking about is in Nehemiah chapter 3, it's going to be going through the different gates that were rebuilt, that were hung, and part of the walls that were rebuilt, and the people that were involved with that. So just kind of bear with me here for a few moments. Let's read the Word of God. Nehemiah chapter 3. Eshelib, the high priest, and his fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. And we're going to talk about each of these gates a little bit and the significance of each of these gates. They dedicated and set its doors in place, building as far as the Tower of 100, which they dedicated, and as far as the Tower of Hanel. The men of Jericho built the adjoining section, and Zakur, son of Amir, built next to them. The fish gate was rebuilt by the sons of Hezaniah. They laid its beams and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. Meremoth, son of Uriah, and son of Hakaz, repaired the next section. Next to him, Meshulam, that's not a name you hear every day, son of Becherek, son of Meshabel, made repairs. And next to him, Zadok, son of Bana, also made repairs. The next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to work under their supervisors. So we're already seeing some opposition, some things that are happening at that time. The Jasana, maybe, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, gate, which is also referenced as the old gate, was repaired by Janata, son of Pasah, and Meshulam, son of Besadiah. They laid its beams and put its doors and the bolts and bars in place. Next to him, repairs were made by men from Gideon and Mizpah. Meleteth, son of Gibeon, and Jadon of Menonoth, places under the authority of the governor of the Trans-Euphrates. Uzel, son of Hananiah, one of the goldsmiths, repaired the next section, and Hananiah, one of the perfume makers, made repairs next to that. And so you're seeing that all these people are coming together, doing different tasks. They're doing different things, and they all were from different backgrounds at the time. They restored Jerusalem as far as the broad wall. Repaniah, son of Hur, ruler of the half-district of Jerusalem, repaired the next section. Adjoining this, Jedidiah, son of Haruf, made repairs opposite his house. This is very difficult. Hattush, I lost my place. Son of Hasabaniah made repairs next to him. Malachi, son of Harim, and Hashab, son of Pathath, Moab, repaired another section, the Tower of the Ovens. We're about halfway done, folks. Bear with me. Shalom, son of Hashaneth, ruler of the Hasith of Jerusalem, repaired the next section with the help of his daughters. Whole family affair. The valley gate was repaired by Hannah and the residents of Zanana. They rebuilt it and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. You're seeing a theme here, right? Bars, bolts in place. All these different things. These gates, they had to be fortified. They also repaired 1,000 cubits of the wall as far as the dung gate, which we'll talk about that. The dung gate was repaired by Malachah, son of Rechab, ruler of the district of Beth Hakkerem. He rebuilt it and put its doors with their bolts and bars in place. The fountain gate was repaired by Shalun, son of Kolhazah, ruler of the district of Mizpah. He rebuilt it, roofing it over and putting its doors and bolts and bars in place. He also repaired the wall of the Pool of Shalom by the king's garden, as far as the steps going down to the city of David. Beyond him, Nehemiah's son of Azbuk, ruler of the half-district of Beth-Zur, made repairs up to the point opposite the tombs of David, as far as the artificial pool and the house of the heroes. Next to him, the repairs were made by the Levites under Rehum, son of Benai. Beside him, Hazabah, ruler of the half-district of Kelah, carried out repairs of that district. Next to him, the repairs were made by the fellow Levites under the Benai, son of Hedidah, ruler of the other half-district, seeing a lot of half-districts here, of Kelah. Next to him, Ezra, son of Jeshua, ruler of Mizpah, repaired another section from a point facing the ascent to the armory as far as the angle of the wall. Next to him, Barak, son of Zabai, zealously repaired, okay? This guy had zeal. He was zealous. I like that. Repaired another section from the angle of the entrance to the house of Eshleb, the high priest. Next to him, Meremoth, son of Uriah and son of Hakaz, repaired another section from the entrance of Eshleb's house to the end of it. Two more little paragraphs. The repairs next to him were made by the priests from the surrounding region. Beyond them, Benjamin and Hashab made repairs in front of their house and next to them. Azariah, son of Messaniah, the son of Ananiah, made repairs beside his house. Next to him, Benanui, son of Hesedad, repaired another section from Azariah's house to the angle and the corner. The Palal, son of Uzai, worked opposite the angle and the tower projecting from the upper palace near the court of the guard. Next to him, Pedadiah, son of Parosh, and the temple servants living on the hill of Ophel, made repairs up to the point opposite the water gate to the east and projecting tower. Next to them, the men of Tekoa, we've heard of them before, repaired another section from the great projecting tower to the wall of Ophel. Above the horse gate, the priests made repairs, each in front of his own house, which is convenient. Next to them, Zadok, son of Amir, made repairs opposite of his house. Next to him, Shemaniah, son of Shechaniah, the guard of the east gate, made repairs. Next to him, Hananiah, son of Selemiah, and Hanun, the sixth son of Zaleph, repaired another section. Next to them, Meshullam, son of Berechiah, made repairs opposite his living quarters. Next to him, Malachiah, one of the goldsmiths, made repairs as far as the house of the temple servants and merchants opposite of the inspection gate, as far as the room above the corner. And between the room above the corner of the sheep's gate, the goldsmiths and the merchants made repairs. I'm done. I don't even know what. Anyways, it's important for us to read through these things. It's important for us to understand. And there's some things that kind of jump out at that, and I want to talk about some of those. So I put this little slide of Jerusalem's walls and gates in your outline there, if you want to take a look at that. And you'll see that in Nehemiah chapter 3, it talks about 10 gates. And so we want to talk about those gates. What do they mean? What does it kind of represent to us today? And why was it important? So number one, the first gate that they build was the what? Sheep's gate. Some of you are like, dude, that was so much reading. Sheep's gate. So the very first gate mentions the sheep's gate. This is where the sheep's gate was important because this is where the sheep and the lambs came and were brought in for sacrifice. The sheep's gate today would help remind us of the sacrifice that Jesus Christ made. And so you'll see in these temples and the way that these walls are constructed, they had different gates for different things. And so the sheep gate was where the animals came in before they were sacrificed. The fish gate was mentioned in Nehemiah 3:3. It's called the fish gate because it was where the fishermen of Galilee would bring their catch through this gate to be sold. What this can remind us of when we're looking at this is that we are to be fishers of men. As those men came into the temple courtyard, as they came through the walls and through this gate to sell their goods, we need to remember to continue to reach out to those people around us, that we are to be fishers of men, and we need to be evangelists and spreading God's word. The old gate in 3:6 is mentioned. This is following the fish gate. Nehemiah is the only book in the Bible where it's called the old gate. And this would have been one of the original gates that was made. And what this can help remind us is that God's ways of truth never change. Amen? God's ways of truth never change. And so even after so much time has passed, God's word, the things that we read in this Bible, the truth never changes. The Valley Gate is another gate that was mentioned. There were several valleys surrounding Jerusalem, and they opened out to the Valley of Hinnom. This can remind us, and this is pretty important for us to understand, is that when we go to camp, when we do mission trips, when God is just working amazing things out in your life, we call those mountaintop experiences. And I'm sure that many of you have experienced in your life those mountaintop experiences when you feel close to God, when you feel like so many things are just going right in your life, that you feel such a connection to God. But here's the amazing thing about mountaintop experiences, is that if you go up to a lot of mountaintops, there's not a lot of growth. Would you agree with that? When you go up to the mountaintops, there's not a lot of wildflowers. There's not a lot of things that can grow because of the altitude, because of the air quality, just different things. Up that high, there's not much growth. When we experience those mountaintop experiences in our lives, the growth is going to happen when we're back down in the valley. The growth that God is going to do in your life has to happen in the valley. And in the valley, we know sometimes it's difficult. We know that in that valley, there are dips, there are curves, there are hills. There are things that go on in our lives that are so difficult to get through. But that's where growth happens, is in the valley, not just on the mountaintops experiences. And sometimes we think about those mountaintops. Man, I just wish I was so close to God when I was on that mission trip, or when I went to camp, I remember that. But we need to have those experiences down in the valley. That growth has to happen down in the valley. The next gate's kind of silly. The dung gate, or they would call it the refuge gate, was mentioned in chapter 3, verse 14. And so this is where all of the refuge, the dung, everything was collected and taken out this gate. You weren't going to take that just through any gate. This was taken through a specific gate. And this is to remind us, and what I see in today is that there's a lot of things that are causing growth not to happen in our lives. There are things that we put in place, that just life has put in place, that it's hard for us sometimes to keep growing. And this is to remind us that we need to take those things out of our lives. We need to remove those things. Just as they remove that stuff from beyond those walls, out that gate, we need to continue to be looking at our lives for the same. The fountain gate in 3:15 is mentioned. It's located near the pool of Siloam and was often used for people for cleaning before proceeding into the temple. This gate can remind us, this fountain gate, is that when we clear out those things in our lives, God can wash us clean. God can use us in such a powerful way if we let him and we come clean before him. The next is the water gate. This is the gate that was led to the Gilan Spring, which is located just adjacent to the Kidron Valley. And this can remind us that same type of thing, is that with the forgiveness and the blood of Jesus that was spilled for each one of us, we can be clean before him. We don't have to continue carrying those sins and those burdens and those things around in our lives, but we can allow him to wash us clean. The horse gate was important. This was close to the king's stables. The horse gate was an important part of Jerusalem. This is where the horses were kept, and they were taken through in and out of this gate before the men were going for missions, before they were going into war. This was the gate that they came to and from. And this is to remind us of the spiritual battles that we still currently go through. We're still currently fighting things in our lives that we need to remember God's power, God's strength to get through those things. Two more gates. The east gate is located opposite side of Mount of Olives. In Zechariah 14:4, we're reminded that when Christ comes back, it's going to be in that Mount of Olives, and that he's going to split the valley. And some would say that he's going to enter back through the east gate. Just the promise of God coming and fulfilling what we believe is that God and Jesus is going to come back for us. And we don't know the date. It could be soon, but Jesus is going to come back for his people. And then the last gate is the inspection gate. And this had a military connection. This is a traditional gate where King David and his troops would come through. And there was an inspection that happened to see if his men were ready for battle. And likewise in our lives, we need to have that same sort of gate where we're checking to make sure that we have the armor of God, that we are strong, and that we are fighting those daily battles in our lives. Amen? So let's take a look at some observations that happen from chapter 3. Number one, Nehemiah was type A. Nehemiah was type A. This man accomplished some things in his life that only a type A person probably could have handled. The organization, all the different things. You would have to be pretty darn organized to accomplish the feat that Nehemiah did. He was able to mobilize and empower 44 separate groups of people to rebuild these walls, which was a daunting task people didn't think could happen, that there was no way it was going to take place. But he pulled off this feat because we know that with God, all things are impossible. He had seen God's favor, that God wanted to make this happen, that God was going to make this happen using Nehemiah as his tool. I looked up on the old Google just some of the differences between type A and type B people. Some of you know exactly who you are. Type A personality traits, some of them, sometimes can be aggressive, ambitious, controlling, highly competitive, preoccupied with status, workaholics, hostile, and lack patience sometimes to you type A's. They're also highly organized. They are good at administration. Those things come naturally to them. So maybe you're sitting there type A going, oh, that doesn't sound very nice. Like, I'm not hostile. I'm not aggressive. But maybe some of those personality traits are you. Type B personality traits are relaxed, less stressed, flexible, emotional, expressive, and have a laid-back attitude. And it doesn't mean that you are completely unorganized, but you just take a different approach to life. So how many of you are type A? Raise your hand. Okay? I would say I have a lot of type A qualities, some type B. How about type B? Raise your hands if you're type B. You emotional people. Yes. Yes. Or highly expressive, I would say. Highly expressive. That's what they said. But we learn about these things. So things that we're seeing from Nehemiah is he was probably a type A. He took charge. He got it done. He was highly organized, and he made it happen with God's power. Number two is we must be all in and work as a team. You'll see that this passage points people working together and accomplishing more. And some of the following phrases that you heard over and over is next to him, next to them, and after him. You heard this over and over in these passages that these people worked together. They worked as a team. And the point is that every person in ministry is to have a job. And we know that. We've seen that we have spiritual gifts. We have things that we can use inside this church, that it's not about just one pastor or two pastors or some staff members, but we all have a part to play in the body of Christ. In the story in Nehemiah chapter 3, we see that the people came together. Nehemiah was the leader. Nehemiah was the organizer. He put it together. He assembled it, but the people carried out the work. What's interesting is in Nehemiah chapter 3, we don't see Nehemiah's name mentioned. We don't see his name mentioned that he rebuilt this gate or he did these things. He was back being a leader and organizing and taking care of all the things that were going to happen with this feat before them. Number three, an observation we see is that it was a team effort. It had to take place with the entire team. It's the same with us. This body of Christ, this community of believers, has to be a team effort. We are all part of it. We all have a part to play, a gifting, whether it's encouragement or whether it's organization, administration. We all have a part to play in the body of Christ. Number four is everyone has something to offer. And sometimes we may not know our spiritual gift or we struggle with what it is, but we all have something to offer this community. And whether it's just be you're a greeter when people come in and you have a smile and a genuine joy, that can be your part that you're contributing to the body of Christ as we fellowship and we meet together. Maybe it's you love wrestling toddlers. That might just be your gift. Some of you are like, nope, already would have been in there. But maybe that's your gift, is that it's kids ministry. You love kids. You're able to work with kids. That can be used as a gift in the body of Christ. Number four, rebuilding often begins at home. We've got to have our homes in order. We've got to have ourselves in check of what's going on in our own lives when we serve and bring something together into the community. Number six is the work was voluntary. These weren't slaves. They weren't ones that were told they had to do this. These men and women and children came together to accomplish God's task that God was doing, rebuilding these walls using Nehemiah and all those people. And number seven is that God was a recorder of names and events. And this reminds me of legacy, is that God remembered these names of these people. It wasn't that he just said, there were some men over there that did this, or those guys over there did this, but he listed them by name because there was something important to that. There was a legacy that was being created. And some of you rockers and some of you parents, you're leaving a legacy for your kids. Bringing them just to church is leaving a legacy. Teaching them about Jesus, teaching them about God is leaving a legacy in your life and in their lives and in your future lives to come after that. I came across this silly little story, and I just want to share with you, but this guy's talking about work and the different jobs that he's had, and it's a little corny. My first job was working in an orange juice factory, but I got canned because I couldn't concentrate. I'm telling you, these are like dad jokes times like 400, but there's a couple of them I want to share. My first job, then I worked in the woods as a lumberjack, but I just couldn't hack it, so they gave me the axe. Uh-huh. After that, I tried to be a tailor, but I just wasn't suited for it, mainly because it was a so-so job. Next, I tried working in a muffler factory, but it was exhausting. I wanted to be a barber, but thank you, Kelly. I heard you. That's right up your alley. I love it. I wanted to be a barber, but I just couldn't cut it. I attempted to be a deli worker, but anyway, sliced it. I just couldn't cut the mustard. I studied a long time to be a doctor, but I just didn't have any patience. I became a professional fisherman, but discovered I couldn't live on my net income. I managed to get a good job working for a pool maintenance company, but the work was just too draining. Next, I found being an electrician would be interesting, but the work was shocking. After many years trying to find steady work, I finally got a job as a historian until I realized there was no future in it. And the last one, I heard another guy say, I like work. It fascinates me. I can sit and look at it for hours. Okay. When it comes to work of God, when it comes to working for God, we can't be sitting on the couch. We can't be sitting on the sidelines. We all have to have what our part is in this church, in this body of believers. And this isn't the only body of believers, right? We have churches, all amazing churches in this town and in our county, in our state, that are worshiping God, and they're working together as body of Christ. And so we're part of that larger body of Christ. And so when another church has a need, we need to come and be a part of that. A couple weeks ago, TJ, it was the code enforcement officer here in Galt, reached out to the churches and asked if there was some of us that could help a couple properties in town become code compliant. And it was a strange ask. It was kind of out there, but he felt like maybe we could just give these people just a chance and just help them become so they didn't get fined and all these things. And of all the churches that was asked in this email, there was just two churches that responded, us and another church, to come help. And it was not easy. We weed-eated and loaded up trash and all those different things at these properties. But I think it meant a lot to those people, and I even drove by two of them yesterday, and they're still kept up, is that, you know, one house, it was a disability issue. They couldn't do the work, and they just needed some help. They needed the church, and what I find amazing is that the police department came to the churches in Galt and asked for help, and I love that. I love that they could come and ask us for help, and we responded. But we've got to be part of what God is doing in our lives. We got to be a part of. We can't sideline it. We can't just wait for the award ceremonies of what Bayside Galt's doing. We need to be a part of what God is doing in and through this church, in our community, and in this world. Nehemiah accomplished an incredible task. He built these walls in 52 days, is what it's recorded as. 52 days to rebuild these walls. And I think there's a picture of these walls, Kelly, somewhere. Yeah, so these aren't like, these aren't like little walls, okay? This is some major masonry work. But he rebuilt with the people, these 44 groups that he had put together, rebuilt these walls in 52 days. He did this because he knew that him and these people were doing it for the glory of God. There was a purpose behind it. It wasn't for themselves, but they knew the place that they had and the task that was at hand. I remember when I went on a missions trip to Africa in college, we went to West Africa, and we went to 5 different countries in West Africa with a choir group that I was a part of. And we would go into some of these villages, and to experience the joy when you don't have really anything to offer, but just you're there spending time with people, to experience that kind of joy it's so contagious. It's so amazing. But we had to remember at times, because we would get tired. I mean, in I think it was Burkina Faso, it was 115 degrees or something with humidity. And we had like traditional outfits on that were not light. And, you know, I went to school in Reading, so it's hot in Reading, but I mean, we were just a mess the whole time, like just sweating. But we had to remember these concerts that we constantly were doing. We put on sometimes 3 concerts a day, but we had to remember why we were doing it. And what was awesome is our choir director at the time taught us songs in the different languages of these concerts that we were going to. And so we were singing songs in their own native tongue. We sang, a lot of them were in French, because that was when the French had colonized that area. And so we had learned these different songs in these languages. And you should have seen the joy when we would, like in Benin, we would sing something in their native language, a song, the faces that would just light up with joy, that we were just singing about God together. And it was just amazing. But I think it's when we remember the purpose of the work, we remember it's not just the heat or the humidity or the struggle. We remember why we're there. God can use us in such a powerful way. I want to just kind of wrap up our time this morning of looking at 6 different principles. When we work together, how do we work well together? And how do we continue to do the work that God has us in and through this church? And so number 1 is leaders set the example. We just had a staff meeting last week with our staff and our leaders here at this church, and also a leadership team meeting that same week. And our devotion for the staff was being a leader that sets an example, being a leader that someone wants to follow. And I had shared an excerpt from Francis Chan. And Francis Chan was talking about sometimes in our lives we think like, well, man, if I had a church, or, you know, if I had this church here, I could do this, or I could do that, or we could do so much more if we had this. And what Francis Chan's point was is that Jesus led and not everyone followed. Jesus spoke truth. Jesus spoke into these folks' lives and healed people, but it wasn't taken very well at times. People looked at him and said, I'm not following that. It's crazy. Whatever you've got, I don't want to be a part of it. And yet Jesus didn't stop and try to think, well, what do I got to do? Do I need to add another Bible study? Do I need to include donuts? Or what do I have to do to keep these people following me? He just kept leading. And that's what we have to continue to do. This church isn't going to be for everyone. We say that. We are very imperfect people. And that's what the body of Christ is. This church won't be for everyone. Some of you might not like the song or the way that we speak or the way we use those communion cups. Or there's going to be something that you're not going to like, but there isn't a perfect church. We are a group of imperfect people just seeking God together. Amen? We are on this road together to support one another. When we struggle, when we fall, we are there to help pick up the pieces, to lean on, and to grab that person alongside, and to be together as a body. That is why we were created for community. Number 2 is God uses a variety of people. And I think that's so important for us to remember that it's beyond Bayside Galt. This is beyond Bayside Galt. And I know if you go to a concert they used to have Promise Keepers and Women of Faith and different things like that. It was amazing to be around other believers in accord and singing and just seeing, man, it's not just the church I go to. Like, it's all of these people, and we're together in this as a community and as a body of Christ. And number 3 is some will not work, okay? And that is difficult. Some in the church aren't going to work. And so it's our job to understand that some aren't going to work. I know that some of the times that we see the most joy and the most connections and community is when we're serving together. When we do a serve day together, like we've gone to Lake Canyon Elementary two different times. We brought, like, the last time, right before COVID, we took 100 of us and went to Lake Canyon Elementary and just did yard work and poured concrete and put sheds together and, like, just to bless that school. We did something where we did a little, and I've told this before, is we did a little bag for every single staff member, teacher, custodian, kitchen worker. Everyone got a bag, and it said, "We love you. Thank you for what you're doing for our kids. Bayside Church, Galt." And we're going to be doing that again. You're going to see, we're going to be doing some outreaches through this church, and we're going to choose one a month. February is going to be these baby bottles. It's called Directions Medical Clinic. Used to be called Pregnancy Resource Center. They do an incredible work in Lodi and Stockton, surrounding areas. And so I encourage you to take one of those baby bottles home, fill it up with change or a $100 bill, whatever you want to do. But fill that up, and I think it's February 28th. We bring them back. And just be able to bless the ministry that's happening in the Direction Medical Clinic. And so we need to continue to do that together. Number four is some do more work, okay? We know that. Some are going to do more work. And that's okay, because we need to continue to help one another, encourage one another, and bring those along. And when you lead, others are going to follow, right? And so if someone sees you serving and the joy that's in your life and in your heart and how God is blessing you, that's contagious. And people are going to come alongside that. Number five is some work with passion. That talked about that guy was zealous in his work when he was rebuilding that gate. We need to be folks with passion. We need to have joy. Even when we have hard times, we have joy through that. And that's what's the amazing thing about joy. It's not happiness. It's joy that's deep down in our lives. Number six is some work as families, and I think that's super important that we continue to work with our families. Rockers, I can't tell you how important it is for you to be such a big part of this church. So many of you work in our Breakaway Summer Kids Camp, and for my kids to see you, whether you're making lunches or you're on our security team or you're teaching our kids, that is a part of the church. My kids need to see your faith. My kids need to see you serving in this church, and you have so much to add. And so I'm so thankful for our rocker group. We have an incredible, we'd call it seasoned adult group, retirees that are a part of this church that are going strong. And just because we retire from a vocation doesn't mean we retire from being a Christian, right? And so you have such an important part of this church, and I just wanted to thank you for that. My kids see it. My kids know the guy that brings the donuts, Ron. I mean, they do. You have a very, like, the part that you're playing on Sunday morning, Ron, speaks volumes to my children, because we just brought donuts back in this church, and it's a big deal. So thankful that COVID we were able to bring those back. So next will be communion cups. But it's important to work as families. I remember we had to replace our water line, and so we took down the nursery ceiling, and I brought my family in to help. I mean, my four-year-old was carrying, I'm sure it had asbestos in it. I hope it didn't. But I hope it didn't. But, I mean, my kids were helping. We were serving together, and it doesn't make us better. It was just, I needed help. And so I called the troops that I knew. I have four kids, so who's all going to the church? Let's go. And but when we serve together, it's amazing the time that you can spend together. And I know even this week I was sharing with some of my kids, like, I'm like, Nehemiah, it's so cool, these different gates. I'm telling about it, you know, with my third grader. And they're like, oh, cool, the dung gate, you know, like, because they, you know, anyways, they're third grade, so it's fun. We've got to continue to work together. We got to work well together as a church. We're imperfect, so there's going to be times when it's going to be difficult, when it's going to be hard. We're going to hit some roads, some bumps in the road, but we're going to continue to press on. And God has got so much for this church. I've been coming here just, I'd say, about 12 years, 11 years, and we've seen so many different changes. We've been through a lot, just kind of, you know, different bumps in our road, where God has called others to go different places, but God continues to work in and through this church. God has a purpose for this church, and it's exciting to be a part of. And so I've got one last thing I just want to talk about. How many of you guys have noticed over the time of the geese that are flying when they're heading south? How many of you guys, raise your hand if you recall that. Okay. And when geese fly south, they form a what? A V. Okay. And what is the reason if there's more geese on maybe one side? Does anyone know there's maybe more geese on one side than the other? there's nothing. There's just more on the one side, so it doesn't matter. But what's awesome is I actually looked this up, and I learned a little bit about geese, and so I really want to share with you about geese this morning. But they fly in a V formation. Geese often cover thousands of miles before reaching their destination. They can only get to where they're headed if they work together. Some facts about their flight pattern. So flying as they do, the members of the flock create an upward current with one another. And by doing this V formation that you see, the flock gets 71%, I don't know how they came up with that, 71% greater flying range than if the goose flew alone. So working together, 71% effective. When one goose gets sick or wounded, two will fall out of formation with it and follow it down, help and protect it before it's ready to come back and to fly again. The geese in the rear formation are the ones that do all the honking. Okay, we always hear that. And it's their way of announcing that they're following, that everything's going well, and the repeated honks encourage those in front of it to stay the course. It's the same with us. Some of you are honkers. When we're working for God, when we're working with what God has in and through this church and in this community, we have to help encourage one another. When someone falls in this church, guys, we got to fall with them. We got to protect them. We got to come alongside them and encourage them. You don't have to have the perfect words to say, because sometimes no words are better. But you need to love them and love them through what they're going through and be there for one another. That is so important. I think the honking thing really caught me off guard, because we would maybe hear it as annoying, but what's awesome is those geese are encouraging. They're saying, all is well. Let's keep going, brothers and sisters. We've got something that we're doing together, and it's the same as the body of Christ. We've got to continue to encourage one another, be there for one another, and God's going to do some amazing things in and through our lives and in and through this church. Would you pray with me as we close? Father God, we just thank you for this morning. God, thank you for the book of Nehemiah and the lessons that we're learning, and even through all the crazy names, God, we're learning about the men and women and the families that came together to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, which was, God, what you had destined Nehemiah for. Thank you that he was obedient, that he stepped up to the call, and that, God, he had the gift of administration to get all these people together and do all these things. We thank you, we love you, and we say this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have our prayer team up front, and so if you want to come forward, and if anyone needs prayer for anything, you got something?
Still here.
Amen.
And it ain't time for me to quit. It ain't my time. But from the bottom of my heart, man, you lifted my family up last week. I made a promise to you I'd be in church on Sunday.
He did say that, yeah. Yep.
I'm going to come and help work with you to help build this church. Mm. It don't matter what color y'all. God created us in his own image.
Amen. Amen. Let's give glory to God. Isn't that awesome? And that's what the church is. And that's a testimony of not any of us, but it's a testimony of what God's doing, right? That God is doing something amazing in and through this church. And that's awesome that we're able to be a part of his story and his life. And so, Guys, we will have our prayer team up front. If you need prayer for anything, please come forward. Get some prayer, but have an incredible week. Tonight, we are doing bingo, okay? It's going to be wild, okay? It's going to be good. So I encourage you, it's a potluck. So one thing we do really well together is we eat and we play together. So we're going to be doing bingo tonight. We're going to be having food together, and it's going to be just loud and fun. And we're going to have some little prizes. Just come tonight and be a part of that at 5 p.m. Guys, God bless you. Have an amazing week.
Stir my faith. I will stand.